All right, friends, moving on to our next set of discussion here. We will begin with question number 120 over here. And along with question number 120, I will be discussing question number 196 as well. So we are going to discuss question number 120 and question number 196. Now, before we come on to that question, it is very important as far as infertility is concerned. Male infertility, again, is a very important aspect of the chapter infertility, which you have to study for your exams. All right. So we will focus on male infertility a little bit here and try to remember what are the important points regarding male infertility. So whenever we talk about male infertility, the first thing that we have to keep in mind is important aspects of semen analysis, right? Now, the semen analysis is again important. It is important that you remember the parameters of normal semen analysis. It is important to remember which among those parameters are the most important aspects, and some basic inputs about semen analysis that you should remember is that the procedure itself, all right, the procedure itself. Now, what do you want to remember about semen analysis is that abstinence is very, very important. The sample is taken after abstinence of around 3 days. So this abstinence is very important to maintain. This period of abstinence is very important to maintain before a sample for semen analysis is deposited. If the period of abstinence is less than 2 days, we might get falsely low counts. And if the semen analysis, if the period of abstinence is around 7 days or more, we can get abnormally necrotic sperms or dead sperms, right? That is why by consensus is chosen that the period of abstinence should be around 3 days. Very, very important point. Next important point, the semen sample. The sample should be obtained by masturbation. It should be a masturbation obtained sample. It should be obtained in a sterile container. And important thing is that condom samples are discouraged. Condom samples are discouraged. Very importantly, the male partner should be giving this sample right there at the lab. So home sample collection is not encouraged. We have to understand that we have to analyze the semen sample before it liquefies, right? So the average time for semen to liquefy, the average time taken for semen to liquefy is around 30 minutes. And the maximum time we can wait before we analyze this sample, the maximum time we can wait is around 60 minutes. So ideally the sample should be given in lab. Ideally the sample should be given in lab because there are time constraints we are dealing with, and therefore the semen sample is ideally collected in the lab. There should be two samples for an abnormal diagnosis, right? And ideally, if we require another sample, it should be taken 3 months apart. Ideally, it should be taken 3 months apart. Now, other important aspects about the semen analysis that we should remember is that the normal parameters, what are the normal parameters that we should remember? Very, very important. There's a long list of parameters. Let me just tell you the important ones here that you should at least at the most remember is pH is more than 7.2. So semen is alkaline, and the major reason for this alkaline secretion is actually because of the seminal fluid. Okay, it is because of the seminal fluid which makes up the bulk of the semen volume, which makes up the contributes to the alkaline nature of semen. All right, so in case of prostatic secretions, when the seminal secretion, seminal fluid is less in the sperm in the semen sample, and there are more of prostatic secretions in the semen sample, the semen sample becomes abnormally acidic. All right, so whenever there are secretions from the seminal fluid, if they are lacking in the semen sample, all right, if the semen sample does not contain adequate amount of seminal fluid, then the pH becomes acidic. The normal volume of the semen is around 0.5 ml. It should be more than 1.5 ml per ejaculate. Then the count, the sperm count, should be more than or equal to 39 million per ejaculate. Okay, it should be more than or equal to 39 million per ejaculate. On an average, it is around 60 to 120. This is the range. The sperm concentration, is calculated per ml. Now, the sperm concentration should be more than 15 million per ml. The progressive motility, very importantly, the total motility, there is a part which is progressive motility, there is a part which is non-progressive motility. It is the progressive motility which is very important, the progressive motility or forward motility, which should be more than 32%. The normal morphological forms, the morphology should be normal in more than 4%, right? And the vitality, the live sperms should be more than 58%, right? So this is what is important about the semen parameters. This is a must that you should remember. Of all this also, it is very must to remember the count, the total count, the sperm concentration, the forward motility, the progressive motility, which should be more than 32%, and the morphology, which should be more than 4%. Out of all these parameters, overall, the most important parameter overall is morphology. Okay, the most important parameter overall is morphology, specifically for the performance of ICSI. This morphology holds the most importance. So the most important parameter overall is morphology. It is very important that morphology is normal for ICSI, because in ICSI what happens, we visually characterize the morphologically normal sperms and we choose those sperms to perform ICSI. So morphology is very important, and this morphology is ascertained by the strict criteria. Which is also known by the scientists who gave this criteria, which is called as the Kruger-Tiger-Berg criteria. Right, so most important parameter overall, morphology. For conventional IVF, it is important that sperms are motile. Okay, that motility becomes an important criteria. For conventional IVF, motility is an important criteria. Okay, for conventional IVF, motility is an important criteria. And if asking overall, then morphology is the most important criteria among the all the semen parameters. All right, now next important point is you have to remember the abnormalities that can happen with semen analysis. So one abnormality is aspermia. You know what aspermia means? Aspermia means absence of semen. Absence of semen altogether is aspermia. It is not absence of sperms, it is absence of semen, which is called as aspermia. What is absence of Sperms, on the other hand, absence of sperms in the semen, absence of sperms in the semen is azoospermia. Azoospermia is absence of semen. On the other hand, oligospermia or oligozoospermia is a sperm count, okay, not total sperm, sperm count or sperm concentration. Sperm concentration less than 15 million per ml, that is oligospermia. Severe oligospermia. Severe oligospermia is when the count is less than 5 million per ml, that is severe oligospermia. Decreased motility is called as necrospermia. Sorry. Decreased motility is called as asthenospermia, right? Dead sperms is called as necrospermia. Abnormal morphology is called as teratospermia. Right? And round sperms is equivalent to loss of acrosomal cap. And such is called as globospermia. Such is called as globospermia. So round sperms is called as globospermia. Now, whenever there are dead sperms, whenever there are necrospermia, whenever there's dead sperms are called as necrospermia. So whenever there are no motile sperms, all right, whenever there are no motile sperms, right, it is important to differentiate whether these non-motile sperms are actually immotile or they have whenever there are non-motile sperms, it is actually important to differentiate whether they are dead or they are simply immotile, right? Whether they are dead or simply immotile. And whenever there are no motile sperms, we do the viability tests. We do the viability tests are done to find out if these non-motile sperms are actually non-motile or they are dead. And for this, we have the supravital dye staining test, supravital dye staining tests, and we have the osmotic sperm swelling test. So at least you should remember the names of these tests, that whenever there are no motile sperms, we perform additional tests which are viability tests to find out whether these immotile sperms are actually immotile or they are in fact dead sperms. All right. Now, next is evaluation of azoospermia. I want you to remember the evaluation of azoospermia or severe oligospermia. This is a very simple basic flowchart I will give you here so that we can answer questions based upon whenever we are talking about azoospermia or we are talking about severe oligospermia, it is very important to remember this flowchart, to remember the evaluation that I am giving you here, because that will help you remember a brief outline of the causes of male infertility, the important ones which we are going to discuss here. All right. So this single flowchart is going to encompass it all for you. So whenever there is azoospermia, right, we want to differentiate between obstructive and non-obstructive causes. All right. Majorly, we want to differentiate between whether there is any obstruction to the outflow of semen or sperms, or there is non-obstructive causes, right? So there can be obstructive causes or non-obstructive causes, right? Now, among the non-obstructive causes, this non-obstructive causes could be because of primary gonadal failure or testicular failure, or it could be a secondary gonadal failure, right? Secondary gonadal failure would simply mean that there is a hypothalamic or pituitary disturbance, which is contributing to the gonadal failure. So there can be any of those two types, right? Now, overall to differentiate between obstructive versus non-obstructive versus primary versus secondary gonadal failure, ideally we want a complete hormonal profile. All right, the complete hormonal profile should include testosterone and should include LH and FSH levels. Ideally, all three basic hormonal profiles should be done. Among LH, FSH, more important is FSH, right? Among LH and FSH, more important is FSH. So ideally, there has to be a complete profile, right? But then, if we have to choose between testosterone and FSH as our first test, next test after azoospermia, detecting azoospermia, it has to be testosterone, right? If we have to choose between testosterone or FSH, we will choose testosterone. If we have to choose any one to differentiate between obstructive versus non-obstructive causes of azoospermia, we will choose testosterone. All right, then between primary gonadal failure and secondary gonadal failure, to differentiate between primary and secondary, to differentiate between these two, we will have to add FSH to our test. All right, but overall, if I were to ask you, there is a man with azoospermia and you have to choose only one hormone test to perform now, we will choose testosterone because it will give us a basic idea whether it is obstructive or non-obstructive. Between the non-obstructive, there can be primary gonadal failure and secondary gonadal failure. To elaborate on that, we will need to perform an FSH. All right. So ideally, entire panel should be done together. But if at all we have to choose one, we will choose testosterone. Now, what can be the results of these tests? The results of these tests could be that there is testosterone is low and our FSH and LH is raised. The other situation can be all the hormones are decreased, and the other thing could be there are normal hormones. Okay, there are normal hormones. So if the testosterone is decreased and FSH and LH is increased, that means there is a testicular failure, right? And the most common cause of this testicular failure is Klinefelter syndrome. The most common cause of primary gonadal failure is Klinefelter's syndrome, which is 47XXY. So therefore, whenever there is a situation when azoospermic male has decreased testosterone and FSH is increased and is diagnosed with testicular failure, we should always perform karyotype in such a situation. Another important thing now here in this flowchart is when all the hormones are decreased, it means there is a hypothalamic or a pituitary cause, and that needs to be evaluated further. Now, we don't want to go into the depths of this because this is not that important. What is important here is whenever there is azoospermia with normal hormones. If there is azoospermia with normal hormones, we are dealing with an obstructive cause. And whenever we are dealing with an obstructive cause, the next step is to do a transrectal ultrasound, which is in short form called as TRUS. Transrectal ultrasound to rule out obstruction needs to be done. We will either find out an obstruction or we will not find out an obstruction. All right. So we can either find out an obstruction. The two conditions that we are going to discuss here is a congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens and the other situation is obstruction of vas deferens. We can either find obstruction of the genital tract. Or we can find out that the vas deferens is actually absent, and which is responsible for the physiological sort of an obstruction, right? So on ultrasound we can differentiate between these two causes. Similarly, ultrasound may not find any obstruction, there might be no obstruction, right? So whenever there is azoospermia, normal hormones, and there is no obstruction, azoospermia and normal hormones and no obstruction, then we have to always test for Y chromosome microdeletions, Y chromosome microdeletions before going forward, okay, before going forward. Now I'll come to this in a while, I'll come to this statement in a while. What I want to elaborate here is that in the evaluation of male infertility, when dealing with an azoospermic male, there is nowhere a diagnostic role for testicular biopsy, right? Nowhere in this flowchart did we biopsy the testes to see if the testes are forming sperms or no, right? The reason for this is that we know that there are no sperms, all right, and we know that there are no sperms in the semen either. The testes is not producing those sperms. Maybe the cause is in the testes itself, or maybe the cause is that the testes is not getting signal from above, from the hypothalamus and the pituitary, to synthesize sperms to lead to the formation of testosterone. Whatever be the reason, we have one situation where the testes are probably not producing sperms, or producing sperms very little or in very less amount, that is severe oligospermia. And the other situation is that the testes is actually producing sperms, but because there is some level of obstruction, either there is a anatomical obstruction in the form of obstruction of the genital tract, or the vas deferens is only absent, so the sperms are not transported into the semen, all right? Whatever be the cause, there could be an obstruction, or there might be no obstruction at all. So if there is obstruction, what is the mode of treatment? The mode of treatment in current clinical practice, the mode of treatment for male infertility doesn't really change much. For example, if there is a hypothalamic or pituitary cause, that cause needs to be dealt with separately. But this is very, very rare. This is a rare event. There is only 1 to 2% incidence of hypothalamic or pituitary cause contributing to male infertility. The more common forms of infertility are testicular failure and the ones which are obstructive. So whenever there is an obstructive cause, we will have to extract the sperms out from above the obstruction. Now this sperm extraction can be done from the epididymis or from the testes itself. And even when there is testicular failure, even when there is testicular failure, the reason that we are not biopsying the testes is because of this very reason, that ultimately for conception purposes we need sperms, and those sperms will have to be extracted out. Now we have techniques like ICSI available, where one sperm can be used to fertilize one egg. And we can use that one sperm to achieve conception in the process of ICSI. So we can begin with very few sperms also and try to achieve artificial conception. All right. So that is why even when there is testicular failure identified, even though there is a decreased amount of testosterone, or it is a primary testicular failure, or it is a secondary testicular failure, it doesn't matter. Ultimately, one thing we will do is we will extract the sperms out of the testes, right? Or try to extract the sperms out of the epididymis if the obstruction is somewhere beyond the epididymis. So ultimately the management has not changed. Sperms are to be extracted. Therefore, no role of testicular biopsy for diagnostic purposes. All right. So there is no role for testicular biopsy for diagnostic purposes. So one thing that we come out of this, One deduction that we make here is that there is no testicular biopsy in a routine evaluation. There is no testicular biopsy for diagnostic purposes, because ultimately the treatment does not change, the management does not change. We can now go for sperm extraction techniques, where we can extract these sperms out of the epididymis, which is called as the microsurgical epididymal sperm aspiration, or we can go for the percutaneous epididymal sperm aspiration, or we can go for testicular sperm extraction. Testicular sperm extraction, right? Now, whenever we are using these sperm extraction techniques, we have to always subject these extracted sperms, always subject these extracted sperms to ICSI, right? Because these extracted sperms have not undergone full maturation and they will need to be subjected to ICSI, because by virtue that they are extracted sperms, before they could undergo maturation, complete maturation in the epididymis, they lack somehow in the motility parameters, right? So therefore, they are always subjected to ICSI. We always subject these extracted sperms to ICSI. Second important fact, I told you earlier here that whenever there are normal hormones and we find no obstruction, we should always test for Y-chromosomal microdeletions. Now, this testing for Y-chromosomal microdeletions again is very important. Why? Because sometimes, you know, these males who are carrying these Y-chromosome microdeletions, they are sterile, right? They are sterile, but they are otherwise normal males, right? Except for the fact that they deal with sterility, right? Now, other important factor here is that such males need to be counseled before using their sperms that these Y-chromosome microdeletions, they are transmitted, they are heritable. So it is quite a possibility that when we use the sperms of this particular male in achieving a pregnancy, then any male offspring that that couple might have will also suffer from sterility. So this Y-chromosome microdeletion testing is required for counseling purposes, that even though we are using your sperms to achieve ICSI, right, even then there is a possibility, you should be aware of that possibility, that your male offsprings could also suffer from sterility. So to counsel, for counseling purposes, this testing for Y-chromosome microdeletions is very important whenever we are dealing with azoospermic males or males with severe oligospermia, right? So this much you should at least know. This in a nutshell, this summarizes your azoospermia, in which the pituitary and the hypothalamic causes are anyways very less incidence wise. They're only 1-2% cases. Otherwise, we are mainly dealing with primary testicular failure or the ones where there is obstruction. Now, this question about azoospermia has also been asked differently in the past, in the sense that sometimes the question is framed in this language. There is a semen sample with low volume semen. There is low volume semen which is acidic in nature and has little or no fructose. Now, whenever there is low volume semen, acidic with little or no fructose, I told you most of the volume of semen, the bulk is made up of the seminal secretion. They contribute to acidity, they contribute to fructose in the semen. If there is low volume or acidic semen, that means the seminal secretions are deficient. This means that the seminal secretions, they are deficient, they are not there. So what does that mean? That could mean two things. That could mean either that the seminal vesicles are totally absent, or that could mean that there is an ejaculatory duct obstruction. All right, the vas deferens opens into the seminal vesicle duct. This is the seminal vesicle. So this is the vas deferens. The seminal vesicle duct opens into the vas deferens to form the ejaculatory duct ultimately. So if there is ejaculatory duct obstruction, even then the seminal vesicle secretions will not be able to enter the semen, right? So whenever we are dealing with this situation, again this can be differentiated by an ultrasound, and we see there can be two possibilities: congenital bilateral absent of vas deferens, or there can be ejaculatory duct obstruction, right? These are the two possibilities that can exist. In congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens, the seminal vesicles are also absent. Seminal vesicles, they are also absent whenever there is congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens. And we remember that whenever we discover a male with congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens, we should also test for CFTR gene, because such males with congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens is usually associated with CFTR gene mutations, and that has other health consequences for that particular male. So we don't let it be at that. Whenever we discover CBAVD, we also test for CFTR gene mutations, right? Other situation here is if there is ejaculatory duct obstruction, we will see that the seminal vesicles, they are dilated. So seminal vesicles here, they are dilated. Dilated seminal vesicles. Now suppose we have ruled out both these situations. Supposing we have ruled out both these situations, there's we don't find CBAVD, we don't find ejaculatory duct obstruction, then we should perform a post-ejaculatory urine analysis. Post-ejaculatory urine analysis to rule out retrograde ejaculation. That is one possibility that we should also keep in mind, right? So these are the three possibilities with low volume semen, acidic secretions with little or no fructose. So now coming back to the questions here. So we have, let us see question number 120 here. According to WHO, the criteria of according to WHO criteria, the characteristics of normal semen analysis are, the answer is A, the volume should be 1.5 ml, count should be 15 ml, morphology 4% and progressive motility 32%. These three characteristics, again, they are very, very important to remember. Similarly, let us see question number 196 here. Let me discuss that question here itself. Obstructive azoospermia. Now, this is a fairly simple question. Obstructive azoospermia is characterized by FSH and LH levels as normal. All right. It is also characterized by testosterone as normal levels. All right. Also, the testosterone is normal. Now, let us move ahead. Let us move with the next question. Question number 120 we have done. Let us move on to question number 122. Question number 122 asks, all of the following are surgeries done in Walt prolapse except. All right. The answer to this question is option number B, colpos suspension. In the previous part of this discussion, we had discussed stress urine continence, where I discussed with you colpos suspension. Colpos suspension is the same as retropubic erythropexies. It involves the Birch colpus suspension and MMK procedures, which are done for SUI. So colpus suspension is done for SUI, and the other surgeries, which are uterosacral suspension, and we have sacrocolpopexy, and we have sacrospinous fixation, they are done for Walt prolapse. When we talk about sacrocolpopexy, this is the best for Walt prolapse. Sacrocolpopexy is the best for Walt prolapse. All right, best surgery for Walt prolapse. Moving on to the next question, question number 123. Question number 123 has already been done. We have discussed this when we were talking about prenatal diagnosis. Question number 124 has been done. Question number 125 has been done. Question number 126, all of the following are supports of the uterus except. Now the answer to this question is broad ligament. Broad ligament is not a support of the uterus. All right. it is just a sheet of peritoneum which is covering the which is encircled, which is covering the lateral part of the uterus and the vagina to the lateral pelvic wall. And remember that the main support of the uterus, the main support of the uterus is actually the pelvic diaphragm, right? And the then the ligaments come into picture. So most important support is the pelvic diaphragm, then the ligaments, and among the ligaments also cardinal ligament is the most important. Okay, among the ligament, cardinal ligament is the most important. Now I just want to change this question a little bit here. If I were to say the option was not in the option, it did not show broad ligament, but on the other hand had uterosacral ligament, okay, if the options, if these were the four options, cardinal, uterosacral, pubocervical and round ligament, then your answer would have been round ligament, because round ligament is also just a false support of the uterus, right? So when you have to answer, when broad ligament is in the options, you take broad ligament. If broad ligament is not in the option and round is given, you should remember that round ligament is also just a false support, hardly forming any supportive structures as such. So again, this you have to remember about the supports of the uterus. Moving ahead with the next question. Identify the instrument that is shown here. This is simple. The instrument is a rocket endocervical brush. This rocket endocervical brush is used to take again a pap smear sample, and pap smear by the liquid based cytology discussed within the last set of the lecture. Ayer spatula, again you should be able to identify this Ayer spatula also. The Ayer spatula looks something like this. On the one hand, it is like this. It's a wooden spatula. That is the Ayer spatula. This is the Ayer spatula. So remember this as well. Ayer spatula is used to take the smear for the conventional pap smear. Now let us move on to question number 128. All right. Now before I move on to question number 128, let me just give you a flowchart of before we are able to answer question number 128, understand two clinical situations with IUCD, intrauterine devices. Understand two clinical questions. Again, these are important. Clinical based questions about IUCD are important. Now, so there are two situations that I'm going to discuss with you, is one missing thread and the other is coperty with pregnancy in situ. Now sometimes there can be a situation, let me just frame it in a case wise scenario here, there a woman comes for coperty removal or any IUD removal, okay, any form of intrauterine device removal, let's say coperty, comes for coperty removal, and you do a per speculum examination, and on per speculum the coperty thread is not seen. Now whenever the coperty thread is not seen, what happens sometimes, that the thread just rolls over inside the os, right? It is there, but it just rolls over inside the os, it becomes invisible. So sometimes, you know, in per speculum examination, if the patient, if you are not seeing the coperty, and if you have instruments handy, the patient is lying on your table, you have the speculum in place, in the same time we can sweep the cervical canal with a cytobrush. We can sweep the cervical canal with a cytobrush, for example with a rocket endocervical brush or any other cytobrush, we can just sweep the cervical canal, and if the thread has coiled inside the cervical canal, it can come out. So this can be done, handy thing to do at that particular time, which is sweeping the cervical canal with the cytobrush. Supposing the thread comes out, well and good, we can pull it out and remove the coperty. Otherwise sometimes that the thread does not come out. When no thread comes out, there are two possibilities. Either the thread has become broken, the thread is torn, the thread has become broken and the copper tea is still inside, or either the situation that the copper tea has been expelled outside, or the copper tea perforated and has got inside the abdomen. So there are three possibilities, and we do an ultrasound at this stage. An ultrasound pelvis is done, right? So whenever there is woman coming with copper tea removal, copper tea thread is not seen. Maybe this step is given, maybe not, this step is not given to you. The next step is an ultrasound pelvis. On the ultrasound, we can either see the copper tea in the uterus. Now we see the copper tea in the uterus, she needs removal. We can try removing in OPD with hook. Try removing in OPD with a hook. If we are successful, well and good. If we are not successful, then we can remove hysteroscopically. Then we can remove hysteroscopically. If there is no copper tea in uterus, if there is no copper tea in uterus, there can be two situations. Either it has perforated or it is has been expelled, but to find that out, we'll have to do X-ray abdomen and pelvis. All right. So, woman come with copper tea removal, comes for copper tea removal, thread not seen, ultrasound done, no copper tea in the uterus. Next step, X-ray abdomen and pelvis. If in X-ray abdomen and pelvis we see copper tea inside the abdomen, we have to remove this copper tea laparoscopically. It cannot be left there lying around like that. So it has to be removed laparoscopically, and if it is not seen, then the woman can be assured that she has expelled the copper tea already. She has expelled the copper tea already. So this flowchart is again in an important flowchart for you, to an important clinical aspect of copper tea which we should remember. Second situation I want to discuss with you is that there is a woman has come claiming that she is pregnant with a UPT positive status, and she says that she had inserted a copper tea. So it is a situation which we call as pregnancy with copper tea in situ. Now, why did pregnancy actually occur when copper tea was in situ? What leads to failure of copper tea? One very common cause of failure of copper tea, or when a woman feels that she has copper tea in place and she turns out pregnant, one very important cause for this scenario is that the copper tea actually got expelled and the woman was never aware of it. All right, so the woman never became aware that the copper tea was expelled, and therefore she became pregnant. The other situation is that sometimes the copper tea gets displaced. It gets displaced from its location, and that also affects the efficacy of copper tea. So whenever there is pregnancy with copper tea in situ, the first step is a pelvic ultrasound. And why the first step is a pelvic ultrasound? Before anything else, the first step is a pelvic ultrasound. This is the first step because we want to rule out an ectopic pregnancy, because we understood and we have read that whenever there is a failure of contraception, especially with copper tea, especially with Mirena, there is more chances of it being an ectopic pregnancy, right? So we do a pelvic ultrasound to rule an ectopic pregnancy. If an ectopic pregnancy is found, it is dealt with accordingly. But if we find an intrauterine pregnancy, right, then the next question is whether this pregnancy is desired or undesired. So it is not up to me to decide to do what about it with the pregnancy with copper tea. It is for the woman to first make up her mind whether she wants to keep this pregnancy or not keep this pregnancy, right? So we have to talk to her about whether it is an undesired pregnancy or whether she is very keen on keeping this pregnancy, whether it is a desired pregnancy. Now, if it is an undesired pregnancy, obviously under the terms of MTP, under the heading of failure of contraception, it is her right to demand abortion. And then if it is an undesired pregnancy, we can go for abortion, right? An important thing to remember, we can offer abortion here. Important thing to remember is that if she chooses surgical abortion, then we remove IUD at the time of surgical abortion. right? And we have to remove the IUD before giving medical abortion. So if she wants to go for mefa and meso as a method of abortion, then we remove the IUD before giving her medical abortion drugs. All right, so this is what you have to do if it is an undesired pregnancy. The other important thing is if it is a desired pregnancy. If it is a desired pregnancy, we have to see, we have to know that we cannot let the pregnancy continue with copper T in place, because with copper T in place, what is the risk? There is risk of infections. There is risk of infections, there is risk of preterm, there is risk of preterm rupture of membranes, right? There is risk of sepsis, and these are the mainly infective complications are a risk to the woman and to the baby, obviously, along with it. There is no risk of congenital anomalies with copper T in place. So if it is a desired pregnancy, we have to see if the strings are seen. If the strings are seen, we can remove the copper T. If the strings are not seen, if one does not see the string, then we have to see where is the copper T. Okay, then we have to see where is the copper T. If the IUD is above the cervix, if the IUD is above the cervix, sometimes, you know, this is the uterus, this is the uterus. A pregnancy is trying to implant here. This is the internal os, this is the external os, this is the cervix. Now, if the IUD is above the cervix, let's say the IUD is lying somewhere here, above the cervix, then there is no point removing this. Then we do not remove. We do not remove, but we counsel the woman that it is not possible to remove the copper T, but you have to counsel her that she, if she still chooses to continue pregnancy with copper T in place, there is a risk of infective complications. All right, but we cannot attempt removal because the IUD is above the cervix. Okay, if the IUD is within the cervix, let's say the IUD is somewhere here, lying somewhere in the cervical canal, then this IUD can be removed, but after counseling. Okay, it can be removed, but after counseling. And what sort of counseling will be done in this situation? The sort of counseling will change. What sort of counseling? Now, the IUD is here within the cervical canal. We are trying to remove it, and we are trying to enter the uterine cavity with some instrument to take this out. Then it can disturb this pregnancy, and there are chances that while removing the copper T, the uterus gets irritated and expels out the whole pregnancy itself. So counseling has to be done regarding the possibility of abortion while trying to remove this copper T. So counseling sort of differs. So when IUD is above the cervix, we are not attempting removal, but we are counseling that if she still chooses to continue the pregnancy, there is risk of infections. So the counseling goes this way. If the IUD is within the cervix, we can remove the copper T, but this time we are counseling regarding to her the possibility of abortion while removing this copper T. Sometimes there can be a situation that there is no IUD seen. If there is no IUD seen, which is more likely the scenario, if there is no IUD seen, that means the IUD was probably expelled. All right, that means the IUD was probably expelled, and that has to be confirmed ultimately whenever the pregnancy is over. Whenever the pregnancy is over, we will do an X-ray after resolution of pregnancy, an X-ray pelvis and abdomen after resolution of pregnancy, to find out if the, to ultimately 100% confirm if the copper T was in fact expelled or was intra-abdominal. Similarly, during an abortion, if there we have been unable to recover the copper T. Then we have to again perform X-ray abdomen pelvis after we have done the abortion to confirm whether or not the IUD was actually expelled or it was lying hidden in the abdominal cavity. So this is the flow chart that you should keep in mind regarding this. Two clinical case scenarios that I have discussed with you were again very, very important. Again, very, very important considering the AIIMS and PGI pattern questions, where clinical based questions, especially AIIMS clinical based questions, are asked. Very, very important. Two scenarios with pregnancy with copper T in situ and missed thread. So now coming to question number 128, and you will be able to understand what I'm trying to say. An intrauterine pregnancy of 10 weeks of gestation confirmed in a 30-year-old fifth gravida para 4 woman with an IUD in place. Patient expresses a strong desire for the pregnancy to be continued. So that was her first concern, whether she wants to keep the pregnancy or no. And she says that yes, there is a strong desire for pregnancy to be continued. On examination, the string of the IUD is noted protruding to be outside the cervical lobe. So we see the string. Okay, we are better off. At least we see the string. Now when we see the string, the most appropriate course of action is to remove the copper T, but you remove the IUD to decrease the risk of infection. To decrease the risk of infection, all right. IUD per se, the presence of IUD per se does not lead to an increased risk of malformations. Moving on to the next question, question number 129 here. Macrosomia is not seen in. Now macrosomia, what is macrosomia? Macrosomia is estimated fetal weight more than 4 kg. As far as the Indian population is concerned, Western books consider 4.5 kg. Bangalore, according to the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecologists, it is 4.5. We, on the other hand, in our population consider birth weight more than 4 kg as macrosomia. So macrosomia is not seen in hydrocephalus. Macrosomia is not seen in hydrocephalus. Hydrocephalus is a completely different thing. It just means that the head circumference is larger than normal. So hydrocephalus is a completely different thing altogether. Macrosomia, on the other hand, means that there is estimated fetal weight more than 4 kg. It is seen in post-maturity. Post-mature fetus, it is seen. Obesity is a risk factor. Maternal diabetes mellitus is a risk factor for macrosomic fetuses, right? So what is the problem with macrosomia here? You have to understand what is the problem with macrosomia here. The most common cause for this macrosomia is mainly diabetic mother, right? And in a diabetic mother, it is the Pedersen has given this hypothesis, which is called as the Pedersen's hypothesis. Now this Pedersen's hypothesis says that whenever there is maternal hyperglycemia, the glucose moves freely across the placenta, reaches the fetus, so there is causing fetal hyperglycemia, right? And the fetus synthesizes insulin in response to this hyperglycemia, so there is fetal hyperinsulinemia, right? So remember, whatever insulin is inside the fetus, whatever insulin there is in the fetal blood is the fetal insulin, fetal hyperinsulinemia, because of fetal beta cell hyperplasia in response to this glucose load. So insulin does not cross the placenta. Maternal insulin does not cross the placenta. So there's fetal beta cell hyperplasia, which causes lipid deposition, right? Now this lipid deposition is mainly in the areas of the abdomen, leading to increased abdominal circumference, increased shoulder diameter, because the fat is deposited in between the two shoulder blades. So all organs are affected with this macrosomia, except for the fetal brain. except for the fetal brain or organs are affected. So apart from this diabetic mother, there are other causes of fetal macrosomia, like maternal obesity is an independent factor. Maternal obesity, post-maturity, right? Post-maturity is an independent risk factor for having macrosomic fetuses, right? And other than that, diabetic mother. Now, a very important problem with this macrosomia is shoulder dystocia. The next problem that we are looking at with this macrosomia is shoulder dystocia. And this shoulder dystocia, again, means there's shoulder dystocia. And the shoulder dystocia also, again, there are many risk factors for shoulder dystocia. One is macrosomia, the other is a diabetic mother. Now what happens if diabetic mother and, you know, average size babies can also have shoulder dystocia, right? There can be babies without macrosomia who have shoulder dystocia, and that is very frequent whenever there is diabetic mother, because in those infants, you know, there is specifically the shoulders are large, shoulder diameter are larger. So despite being average weight, they can suffer from macrosomia. Then maternal obesity is another risk factor for shoulder dystocia. Post maturity, again, by virtue of macrosomia, by virtue of absence liker. Prolonged labor is another risk factor. Instrumentation is another risk factor. And among the two types of instrumentation, vacuum, more specifically vacuum application, leads to shoulder dystocia, right? Now, so whenever there is shoulder dystocia, that means the shoulders are held at the shoulders are held at the inlet, right? The head comes out and then recedes back. So shoulders are held at the inlet, the head delivers, and that the head recedes back. The head recedes back on the perineum, and this is called as turtle sign, right? Now, whenever there is shoulder dystocia, the next how do we start acting is called something called as the shoulder dystocia drill. There is a drill, that means a maneuver have to be performed. Shoulder dystocia drill is performed, maneuvers are started, and help is called. So we call for help, then there is an assistant who will start giving the suprapubic pressure, right? Suprapubic pressure, and then McRoberts maneuver will need to be performed. McRoberts maneuver, we need minimum two extra people to be able to do this maneuver, ideally three, but minimum two extra people to do this maneuver. McRoberts maneuver, we should remember the names of these maneuvers: suprapubic pressure, McRoberts maneuver. If you are able to deliver the shoulders and deliver the baby by the first two maneuvers, well and good. As and as we delayed, a delay of around 3 minutes, if we are delaying around 3 minutes, we are going to get a severely hypoxic baby. The chances of getting a normal baby decrease. We'll get a severely hypoxic baby. That is why acting in urgency is utmost significance here. Then you should remember certain other maneuvers, names of maneuvers you should remember. There's a wood screw maneuver, which is the wood corkscrew maneuver. Then we have the Rubens maneuver, bringing down the posterior arm. Gaskins all four. Alright, it is important to know these two maneuvers in detail, and rest you should remember the name at least. Gaskins on 4, cleidotomy, fracturing the clavicle, and we have the Zavanelli maneuver, we have the symphysiotomy. All these are morbid maneuvers, and if we are going down this road, chances of getting a live baby decreases significantly. Another important point to remember here, that the most common fetal complication resulting out of shoulder dystocia is a brachial plexus injury, a brachial plexus injury. Apart from this, fracture humerus, fracture clavicle, they are other complications, but the most common complication is fetal brachial plexus injury, and the most common maternal complication that happens after shoulder dystocia is actually postpartum hemorrhage, PPH, very, very important. Atonic type. Okay, so this is about this question. We can move on to the next question now. Question number 130. Mullerian duct anomaly may include the absence of any of the following. Now, this is a simple question. Mullerian duct anomaly can lead to the absence of uterus, can lead to the absence of vagina, uterine tube, but not the ovary. Why? Simply because uterus, vagina, uterine tube, these are the structures which are developing from Mullerian duct. We have talked about development in detail in the first section of this discussion here, so we will not go into the detail on that. And we know that ovary develops from the genital ridge and not from the Mullerian duct. So this was a fairly easy question. Now let us move ahead. Moving ahead with next question. Puperium is the period following 6 weeks following delivery. Now, this is fairly simple here. Moving on to the next question, no explanation required for this one here. A second 132 question has been done already. We've done this while dealing with preeclampsia. Lochia serosa persists up to 5 to 10 days. So remember, lochia, what is lochia? Lochia is the decidua that is shed after delivery. Lochia is the decidua basalis which is shed after delivery. So placental separation actually takes place across the decidua spongiosa or spinosa, right? And the rest is the decidua basalis which is left behind, the decidua basalis which is shed along with necrotic tissue. So that is what makes up the lochia mainly. So initial first 1 to 4 days is the lochia rubra. It is red in color, right, containing the blood cells also, necrotic blood, necrotic tissue. Then in the 5 to 10 days it is lochia serosa. It contains now serous, it becomes serous, it becomes yellowish. And the last, beyond the 10 to 15 days, the lochia is lochia alba. It becomes white because of the presence of WBCs, and this is the usual pattern of lochia rubra, serosa and alba. So remember this. This is a little bit of extra information here. Moving on to the next question. During pregnancy, there is reduced risk of which of the following condition? Now, in this situation here, there is reduced risk of relapse of multiple sclerosis. Okay, I do not want to go into the medical details of these conditions, but remember that sometimes in pregnancy, you know, Bell's palsy, the facial nerve palsy, idiopathic can occur, meningiomas, again meningiomas. Because what happens is that there is pituitary gland hypertrophy, which normally takes place in pregnancy, right? The pituitary gland in pregnancy, pituitary gland hypertrophies by about 135% during pregnancy, right? And that is why sometimes, you know, meningiomas, they can increase in pregnancy. Sometimes, you know, a new movement of pregnancy, sometimes they can be chorea gravidarum, sometimes they can be new movements in pregnancy which is called as chorea gravidarum. But multiple sclerosis on the other hand improves during pregnancy. There is reduced risk of acute episodes of paralysis in multiple sclerosis during pregnancy. In multiple sclerosis specifically, what is seen is a improvement during pregnancy, followed by an increased severity, increased attacks postpartum. This is specifically seen in multiple sclerosis. There is improvement during pregnancy, followed by increased attacks in the postpartum period. Moving on to the next question, question number 135. 25-year-old female presents with history of recurrent abortions. Alright, a 25-year-old female presents with history of recurrent abortions. The most relevant test for identifying the cause here. So, recurrent abortions, what is the most relevant test here? Among all these tests, it is the dilute Russell Viper Venom test. Alright, now dilute Russell Viper Venom tests actually test for the lupus anticoagulant. This is testing for the lupus anticoagulant, and we are testing for the lupus anticoagulant for antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, APLA, which is one of the important causes of recurrent abortion. So when we are talking about the causes of recurrent abortions, when we are talking about the causes of recurrent abortions, we are talking about most of the times recurrent abortions, most common cause is actually idiopathic. Idiopathic means that no cause is usually found out. So most common cause is idiopathic, and then in order of frequency the next common is the immunological causes. Among the immunological causes, APLA, we can have the APLA is one of the important causes. And remember, APLA, most importantly, APLA is responsible for second trimester losses mainly. But it doesn't mean that it cannot cause first trimester losses. It can cause first trimester losses also, but mainly it is important for second trimester losses. So idiopathic, we have immunological, then we have uterine structural anomalies, then we have the hormonal causes, various hormonal causes. Among uterine structural anomalies, we can have septate uterus or bicornuate uterus, and we have the cervical incompetence. We can have the cervical incompetence as a uterine structural anomaly. Among the hormonal causes, we can have PCOD, we can have hypothyroidism, we can have hyperprolactinemia. Right, so these are the causes. We can have diabetes mellitus, which can cause recurrent abortion. So these are the hormonal causes. Then we have the infections, can be another cause, infections. Right, and another important cause is the chromosomal abnormalities. Now remember that chromosomal abnormalities are the least common of the lot. Chromosomal abnormalities are the least common of the lot, and even when chromosomal anomalies do lead to recurrent abortions, they are not aneuploidies. All right, so when we talk about the most common cause of first trimester or second trimester, any spontaneous abortion, when we talk about the most common cause of first trimester or second trimester spontaneous abortion, the answer is chromosomal abnormalities. All right, when we're talking about spontaneous abortion. Now these chromosomal abnormalities in case of spontaneous abortion, they are different. They are most commonly aneuploidies. And even among aneuploidies, it is trisomies. The most common is trisomies as a group. So if you go by order, it will be aneuploidy, trisomy, monosomy X, and then trisomy 16. Alright, so if you go by the order of most common, it will be aneuploidy. If that is not in the option, trisomy. If that is not in the option, monosomy X. If that is not in the option, trisomy 16. So trisomy as a group is more common than monosomy X, but the most common individual abnormality is monosomy X, that is 45XO. Talking about spontaneous abortions, be it in the first trimester or be it in the second trimester. But when we talk about recurrent abortions, then chromosomal abnormalities which lead to recurrent abortions, they are different. Chromosomal abnormalities leading to recurrent abortions will usually happen in the first trimester. They will not go past the first trimester, and they are mainly balanced translocations. And these balance translocations, they are actually carried by the parent. Okay, they are actually carried by either parent. These balance translocations are carried by the either parent, and when the fetus, when the conceptus has an unbalanced translocation, that fetus aborts. All right, so whenever the parent, either of the parent, carries balanced translocation, these are heritable translocations, they can be transmitted, and that leads to unbalanced gametes. And unbalanced gametes sometimes can lead to unbalanced translocations in the embryo, and that embryo will abort. So recurrent abortions, when chromosomal abnormality, it is balanced translocation, another important factor to remember. Another important factor to remember regarding the causes and the investigations is that in recurrent abortion, most of the times it is idiopathic, right? And then we have a very limited set of investigations which we can offer to these recurrent, to these women. Chromosomal analysis of the conceptus and chromosomal analysis of the parents is the last test to be offered, because even though we find balanced translocation in the either of the parent, we really cannot offer much as a mode of treatment here. The only thing that can be offered here would probably be a pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, because we are dealing here with gametes which are going to form naturally, right? And then we'll have to choose between we cannot even choose the type of gamete which we are able to fertilize. So it is a high end thing that I am discussing here. What I am trying to say here is that even though we find that the cause is a balanced translocation in either of the parent, there is not much we can do about it. At the most, we can offer that couple IVF and pre-implantation genetic diagnosis to help implant or to help the transfer of only that embryo which seems to be genetically balanced. All right, success or no success is a late question in that regard. So not much of a treatment can be done for this. Therefore, it should be investigated in the last. So when we talk about the investigations which are offered for a recurrent abortion couple, a couple that is dealing with recurrent abortion, the investigations which have a definite role are a complete blood count of the female, with a platelet, specifically with the platelet count. We want a platelet count more importantly. Secondly, we want to do a TSH. Thyroid function test, TSH and anti-TPO antibodies, they are done. TSH and anti-TPO antibodies. Third, we want to test for APLA. Testing for APLA is very important. Antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. Testing for APLA. In the testing for APLA, we test for lupus anticoagulant. We test for anti-cardiolipin antibody. And we test for anti-beta 2 glycoprotein, all right? So when we test for lupus anticoagulant and anti-cardiolipin antibodies and anti-beta 2 glycoprotein, these are the three lab parameters which we test for APLA. Now, with the lupus anticoagulant, usually what happens, the test for this, testing for this lupus anticoagulant, we test by the dilute Russell Viper venom test. Okay, so we do not directly lupus anticoagulant to be test for lupus anticoagulant. We test by you doing the dilute Russell Viper venom test. So that is an important thing to remember here. These anticardiolipin antibodies, beta 2 glycoprotein, they are raised in medium to high titers. They should be raised in medium to high titers. And ideally, these lab parameters should be abnormal on two occasions, 12 weeks apart. Ideally, they should be abnormal on two occasions, 12 weeks apart, and they should be done in the non-pregnant state, ideally. Okay? Then the fourth test that we do is the testing for blood sugar, testing for prolactin, this is done if symptomatic. This is done if symptomatic. Or suspected. But at least these three tests have definite role. These three tests have definite role. And the fifth test that is tested is some assessment of uterine cavity. Assessment of uterine cavity at least by an ultrasound. We can go for sonosalpingography also. We can go for at least a sonosalpingography required. So some or the other assessment of, or maybe a hysteroscopy, if required, but some test to assess for the uterine cavity. So definite role of this TSH testing for APLA, definitive assessment role of assessment of uterine cavity. These four tests are a baseline must that are always offered to a woman with recurrent abortions. Next important aspect that I want to tell you here is infections. There is no role of torch testing. There is no role of torch testing because these infections which are tested in torch, these lead to spontaneous abortion. Okay, torch does not cause, torch set of infections does not cause recurrent abortion, it does lead to spontaneous abortion. Therefore, there is no role of torch testing. If at all you were to be asked which infection can cause recurrent pregnancy loss, then the answer to this question would be syphilis. Syphilis is one infection which can cause recurrent pregnancy loss. Another important aspect about syphilis is that syphilis follows something which was called as the Kassovitz law. This Kassovitz law just simply states that the pregnancy outcome of a woman who is suffering from syphilis actually improves with gestation. So what does that means? That syphilis causes stillbirth more commonly than it causes abortions, right? What I mean is that outcome with subsequent pregnancy improves. So if in the first pregnancy she had an abortion, let's say in the first trimester, in the second pregnancy she will form an abortion in the second trimester, then a stillbirth, and then probably a live birth later on. So outcome with subsequent pregnancy improves. That is what is the case with syphilis. But in a nutshell, you should remember that syphilis can cause RPLs, recurrent pregnancy loss, but syphilis causes stillbirth more than it causes abortions. Alright, so this is in a nutshell about recurrent pregnancy loss. So we realize that we do not, and if we identify syphilis as a cause of recurrent pregnancy loss, syphilis needs to be treated. If we identify thyroid disorders as a cause of recurrent pregnancy loss, that needs to be treated. If it's a diabetic woman, that needs to be treated. If it is a septate uterus or any other uterine abnormality, that needs to be dealt with. So we realize that we actually treat the cause, right? So there is something which is called as, for the treatment of APLA, we use low dose aspirin and low molecular weight heparin are used for the treatment of APLA. All right, and they are to be given throughout pregnancy. This is the first line and the one which is most important and which has some benefit. Apart from that, there is second line treatments like IV immunoglobulins and plasmapheresis. Their benefit is actually doubtful, but nonetheless, this is the only second line treatment that we have for idiopathic recurrent pregnancy loss. Where we did not found out any cause, there is no role established of low dose aspirin and low molecular weight heparin. All right. So for idiopathic RPL, where there is no APLA also, there is no established role of low dose aspirin and low molecular weight heparin. Now, coming back to the next question here, all of the following are true about Krukenberg's tumor except. Large cystic spaces, Krukenberg's tumor. What is Krukenberg's tumor? Krukenberg's tumor is a tumor which is a metastatic tumor to the ovary. It is a metastatic tumor to the ovary. It has large cystic spaces, true. It maintains the ovary shape, true. It is bilateral. No. Sorry, the correct answer to this question is A, large cystic spaces. That is false. It does not have large cystic spaces. It has signet ring cells. It has signet ring cells on histopathology. That is not synonymous with large cystic spaces. It maintains ovarian shape. That is also true. These are bilateral tumors, true. And they are usually from carcinoma stomach. That is also true. Now, the reason why Krukenberg tumor spreads from the stomach carcinoma to the location of the ovaries, the reason for this is actually by retrograde lymphatics. Okay, it spreads via retrograde lymphatics. What does retrograde lymphatic mean? It means that the superior gastric lymph nodes, they receive the lymphatic supply from the stomach as well as from the from the ovaries. So therefore, via retrograde lymphatics, tumor can spread from the stomach to the ovary, and that is what happens in a Krukenberg's tumor, right? And they are usually bilateral. That is also true. Ovary shapes is maintained. So in other words, this also means that the capsule is intact. The ovarian capsule is intact. That is what it means. Large cystic spaces is not true statement. They have signet ring cells on histopathology, which is not synonymous with cystic spaces. Question number 137, name the condition shown in the figure. Now, this condition, again, clearly it is a Bartholin cyst. This Bartholin cyst, you can see the location here. It is in the posterolateral aspect of the labia, posterolateral aspect. And this is what is a Bartholin cyst. Now, this Bartholin cyst, when it is a Bartholin cyst, you should remember that the Bartholin's gland, remember that this is not a Gartner's duct cyst. Gartner's duct cyst is seen in the vagina in the anterolateral aspect and is not so clearly evident externally. Nabothian cyst is on the cervix. Chocolate cyst is the cyst which is, its chocolate cyst is an endometriotic cyst of the ovary. Chocolate cyst is actually an endometriotic cyst of the ovary, so it is a completely separate issue. In the Bartholin's versus Gartner's cyst, Gartner's duct cyst is more commonly seen in the anterolateral aspect of the vagina. So it will not be seen at the labia here. So clearly this is Bartholin's cyst. Now remember that this Bartholin's gland, the gland itself lies in the superficial perineal pouch. The gland itself lies in the superficial perineal pouch. This Bartholin's gland is also called as the greater vestibular gland. It is also known as the greater vestibular gland. It is homologous to the Cowper's gland of the male. Right? So Bartholin's gland is homologous to the Cowper's gland. Gland itself is located in the superficial perineal pouch, but the duct opens in the vagina just outside the hymen. Right? between the junction of anterior two-third and posterior one-third, all right? So there is when the duct opens, and it can sometimes lead to blockage. The blockage of duct opening can lead to Bartholin's gland cyst. Sometimes that cyst can get infected, and the most common organism responsible for this infection is E. coli, and then it can lead to a Bartholin's gland abscess. Abscess anywhere, like anywhere in the body, the treatment for this abscess is incision and drainage. But if it is a cyst, the treatment is marsupialization. And if it is a cyst in a woman who is more than 40 years of age, then the treatment is excision because of the risk of malignancy. Because of the risk of malignancy, then in that situation, the treatment is excision. Alright, the treatment is excision of the gland. So this much you should remember about the Bartholin's gland and the Bartholin gland and its cyst. Moving on to the next question. This has been done. This question about the twin, question number 139, has been done. Identify the instrument shown below. Now this is a cervical biopsy forceps. This is a cervical biopsy forceps. You have to remember that. A tenaculum and a valsalum are instruments which are used to hold the cervix. Okay. So the instruments used to hold the cervix, they are different, and EB curette is a different instrument altogether. Now which of the following is not, moving on to the next question, which of the following is not caused by oxytocin? Now lactogenesis is not caused by oxytocin. Milk ejection, oxytocin is the milk ejection hormone. We know it causes contractions of uterine muscles. Myoepithelial cell contraction, that is how it leads to milk ejection, because it causes myoepithelial cell contraction. Lactogenesis, on the other hand, is achieved by prolactin. But you have to understand that prolactin alone does not lead to lactogenesis. Okay, prolactin alone does not lead to lactogenesis. Remember that when we talk about lactogenesis, lactogenesis is not like a hormone will start acting today and it will start synthesizing milk. No, lactogenesis needs preparation. It needs 9 months of preparation during the entire period of pregnancy, that the breasts are preparing, the ducts, the alveolar system is developing in anticipation of milk formation, right? And you have to also understand that all throughout pregnancy, milk, when the breasts are preparing, right, and the prolactin levels are so high. So we remember that lactogenesis, prolactin is the main hormone. Okay, prolactin is the main hormone. Apart from this prolactin, the entire milk secreting apparatus is becoming ready. Now this milk secreting apparatus is becoming ready. To make this milk secreting apparatus, estrogen, progesterone, insulin, all these hormones also contribute, mainly estrogen and progesterone. Alright, mainly estrogen, progesterone. Prolactin is the main hormone, and you have to understand that during the entire pregnancy, prolactin levels are rising. So prolactin levels increase in pregnancy because of increased estradiol in pregnancy, right? So prolactin levels are increasing in pregnancy because of increased estradiol levels in pregnancy. But understand, there is no milk secretion in pregnancy. During pregnancy, there is no milk secretion. Milk secretion is suppressed during pregnancy because of the inhibiting effects of progesterone. But active milk secretion is suppressed in pregnancy because of the inhibitory effects of progesterone, because of high amounts of progesterone at the same time. Now what happens after delivery? After delivery, what happens? Prolactin levels actually fall. Actually, the prolactin levels fall. Then what secretes milk? What leads to secretion of milk? So the first stimulus for milk secretion is actually withdrawal of progesterone. That is the first stimulus for milk secretion. Okay, so after delivery, the first stimulus for milk secretion is actually withdrawal of progesterone. Prolactin levels, they fall after delivery. Alright, now, so that is why you realize that immediately after delivery, mature milk is not formed. It is initially just the colostrum which comes out. Mature milks take 3 to 4 days to come when the progesterone levels are completely withdrawn, right? And then for milk sustenance, for milk sustenance, that milk secretion continues. It is actually continuous suckling, infant suckling, that promotes milk sustenance. Okay. And during episodes of suckling, there are bouts of rise of prolactin, right? But it is in fact continuous infant suckling which is the stimulus for milk sustenance, milk secretion. Now, moving on to the next question. 142 has been discussed. Moving on to the next question here. 18-year-old girl presents with amenorrhea, milk discharge, weight loss. Diagnosis is, now she is amenorrhea, milk discharge. So there is, at least we know that there is prolactin increase and weight loss. Now you have to understand here in this question that there is something causing the increased prolactin, right? Now in something causing increased prolactin, we have doubt between two options. It is not anorexia nervosa. The clinical picture does not say particularly anything about milk discharge. On the other hand, means that there is an increased prolactin, and it is not a hypothalamic cause again, because weight loss will go against the diagnosis of a hypothalamic cause. Characteristic about here is that the milk discharge, so galactorrhea. So it could be between pituitary cancer and hypothyroidism, but it is not hypothyroidism. I will here go for pituitary cancer because of weight loss. So weight loss is a feature of malignancy here. So therefore, weight loss, I will go for pituitary cancer. With hypothyroidism, usually there is an abnormally, increase in weight gain. There is a weight gain rather than weight loss that happens with hypothyroidism. Therefore, by exclusion, the answer to this question is a pituitary cancer. Moving on further, question number 144. Which of the following congenital anomalies is seen with maternal usage of cocaine? So maternal usage of cocaine leads to cerebral infarction. This is a more or less a direct question here. Sacral agenesis, is with maternal diabetes. High drops, we have talked about. So this is a pretty direct question, cerebral infarction with maternal cocaine use. Question number 145, we have discussed question number 145 earlier when we were talking about heart disease in pregnancy. Question number 146 also we have discussed along with doing heart disease in pregnancy. Question number 147. A pregnant 35-year-old patient is at high risk for concurrent development of which of the following malignancies? Now see, you don't need to mug up for this question. She is a 35-year-old patient. Pregnancy is a chance event in her life that has happened at that point of time, right? So a 35-year-old woman has a risk of concurrent development of CS cervix. CS cervix is the cancer which has this bimodal peak of incidence between the 30s and the 40s. Of all the cancers that a woman is to be, and CS cervix is also the most common gynae cancer in women. CS cervix is the most common gynae cancer in Indian women. It is the second most common overall cancer, the most common being breast, most common being CA breast, right? So among all of this, again, because of the age that she is 35, she is more prone to have CA cervix, okay? Now, moving on to the next question. Question number 148 we have discussed earlier while doing ectopic pregnancy. Let's move on to question number 149. The risk of thromboembolism increases in pregnancy because we know that pregnancy is a hypercoagulable state. So pregnancy is a hypercoagulable state. Okay, pregnancy is a hypercoagulable state. All clotting factors are increased except for factor 13 and factor 11. We have discussed this while discussing the maternal adaptation to pregnancy. So we realize that viscosity of the blood increases, that is also true. There is increased viscosity of blood, the correct answer for this question is increased hepatic production of clotting factors. That is the correct answer. All right. The viscosity of the blood in pregnancy actually decreases. Okay. In pregnancy, despite being a hypercoagulable state, despite the fact that clotting factors are increased, the viscosity of the blood does not increase. Why? Because there is hemodilution. Viscosity of blood, it doesn't increase because of hemodilution. Now you have to understand one base, and okay, and before I come to that, increased antithrombin 3 levels. Antithrombin 3 is an anticoagulant factor. Pregnancy, all procoagulant factors are increased. So antithrombin 3 levels are not increased in pregnancy. Antithrombin 3 levels are not increased in pregnancy. Progesterone levels are increased in pregnancy, but that has nothing to do with the risk of thromboembolism. Now, one important concept that I want to give you here to understand the doubt here about viscosity increasing and about the clotting factor increasing, you have to understand that why in pregnancy all these increasing amount of clotting factors are happening in pregnancy. Now in pregnancy, on one hand there is hemodilution, on the other hand there is an increase in clotting factors, right? Now these increase in clotting factors which happens in pregnancy happens for a particular reason, that is after delivery, you know, hemostasis has to be maintained. So clotting factors will come in handy at that point in time. So they are increased throughout pregnancy. But the side for this increase in clotting factor, the other problem that we are dealing is, again, increase in clotting factor would lead to increase in blood viscosity. But that is countered by the hemodilution that accompanies pregnancy, right? Now, this hemodilution that happens throughout pregnancy is actually for this very reason, that when the clotting factors, the amount of total proteins which are flowing in the blood, they are going to increase, the blood flow will become sluggish. Right now, to counter that, this hemodilution comes as a protective effect. Okay, and on the other hand, this hemodilution in pregnancy is an imperative event, because ultimately after delivery it leads to another protective role, that it protects against the blood loss that happens during pregnancy. Why? Because obviously when the woman is hemodiluted, more plasma is lost in comparison to RBCs. So this hemodilution offers protection in two aspects. Once during pregnancy, it prevents the blood from getting sluggish, and secondly, after delivery, it protects the woman against the imperative blood loss that happens during pregnancy to all women, which happens because, again, the plasma will be lost more as compared to RBCs because of this hemodilution. So hemodilution in pregnancy serves two important additional protective functions. All right, and we remember here that the thromboembolism risk in pregnancy is because of the increased hepatic productions of clotting factors. Let's move on to question number 150. A 20-year-old female presents with excess facial hair and oligomenorrhea, increased levels of free testosterone, and normal ovaries on USG. Most likely diagnosis is APCOD. Now, oligomenorrhea here. Now, see, this it is not adrenal hyperplasia, because again, adrenal hyperplasia is not such a common event, and there is just mild hirsutism. There is only mild hirsutism that is there. All right, facial hair, just excess of facial hair is there. There are no virilizing signs here, so adrenal hyperplasia is not the answer. Idiopathic hirsutism is again not an answer, because again here we're talking about oligomenorrhea. So associated oligomenorrhea is there, a menstrual disturbance is there, that goes more in favor of PCOD. It is not again a testosterone secreting tumor. So again, because of the excess facial hair and no other virilizing signs, and therefore PCODs are answer. Again, PCODs are answer because it is the most common cause of secondary amenorrhea or oligomenorrhea. It is the most common cause of oligomenorrhea or secondary amenorrhea, right? And the diagnosis is PCOD, even though there are normal ovaries on ultrasound. Why? Because two of the three Rotterdam's criteria are fulfilled. All right. So let me just give you a brief here. Whenever there is, what is the Rotterdam's criteria? The Rotterdam's criteria for PCOS diagnosis. Okay, for Rotterdam's criteria for diagnosis of PCOS requires 2 out of 3 should be present to make the diagnosis of criteria, make the diagnosis of PCOS. The first criteria is history of oligomenorrhea or amenorrhea. So history consistent with anovulation, basically. Second is a biochemical or clinical evidence of hirsutism, of hyperandrogenism. Okay, so either there is clinical evidence of hyperandrogenism in the form of hirsutism, or there is a biochemical evidence in the form of increased serum testosterone levels. Either could be there. And the third is the USG findings. The USG findings showing more than or equal to 12 follicles in either ovary, or the volume of the ovary more than 10 ml. So that either this or that, that will mean that it is an ultrasound diagnostic feature. And you have to understand that about 25% of normal females, 25% of normal females can have polycystic ovaries. So if there is no history of oligomenorrhea, no hyperandrogenism, and ultrasound showing only polycystic ovaries, then it is not PCOS, okay? Because 25% of normal females can have polycystic ovaries. 2 out of 3 should be present. Oligomenorrhea, hirsutism are enough to classify the woman as PCOS. Serum testosterone might be increased, might be normal. So there is hyperandrogenism is the second criteria, be it clinical, be it biochemical, either. Okay, sometimes there can be oligomenorrhea, no hirsutism, but increased testosterone. Or even in that situation, the diagnostic criteria of PCOS is met. Or there can be hirsutism with no oligomenorrhea, but there is USG findings of polycystic ovaries. So either these two also will make the diagnosis of PCOS, all right? So important is this, to remember the Rotterdam's criteria for the diagnosis of PCOS. You have to remember this, and you have to remember that 2 out of 3 are present, right? Now, to make the diagnosis of PCOS, you need to test only one hormone that is required to be tested, that is serum testosterone. FSH levels, they are not diagnostic. They are not diagnostic, but you should also remember that the LH is raised, okay? The LH is raised, and this LH FSH ratio is usually more than 2:1. However, it is not diagnostic, okay? Another important hormonal change to remember in PCOS is that the sex hormone binding globulin levels, they are decreased in PCOS, and this is also again very important to remember. Another thing to remember is whenever there is a rapidly, now this in PCOS, the hirsutism is characteristically mild, okay? For grading hirsutism, we use a classification which is called as the Ferriman-Galway scoring. Okay, if the score is more than 8, it means there is significant hirsutism, right? Now, what happens is that whenever there is rapid rapidly progressing hirsutism. Whenever there is rapidly progressing hirsutism, we have to exclude other causes other than PCOS. PCOS, the hirsutism with PCOS is usually gradual. The testosterone levels with PCOS are usually mildly elevated, not majorly elevated. So rapidly progressing hirsutism, we have to rule out other causes. So we have to do along with serum testosterone, we should test for serum DEHEAS level, DHEAS levels. And also hydroxyprogesterone levels. Okay. In addition to doing serum testosterone level, we should also test for DHS and 17-hydroxyprogesterone levels. If the serum testosterone levels are raised more than 200 nanogram per deciliter, we should look for a testosterone secreting tumor. Now, this testosterone secreting tumor could be a testosterone secreting ovarian tumor example. If these serum DHEA levels are raised, that means there is an adrenal tumor, there is an adrenal source of this excessive amount of DHEAS. And if the 17-hydroxyprogesterone levels are raised, it means there is a non-classical congenital adrenal hyperplasia, right? So at least these three should be excluded in a rapidly progressing hirsutism. So important point again to remember, in a rapidly progressing hirsutism, we should also, apart from serum testosterone, also test for DHEAS and 17-hydroxyprogesterone levels. Now moving on to the next question here. Which of the following is true about Mayer-Rokitansky-Custer-Hauser syndrome? All right. Now, the correct answer to this question is, option number B. Now this option number B is the correct answer by exclusion. All right. Mayer-Rokitansky-Custer-Hauser syndrome, Mullerian agenesis here. All right, Mayer-Rokitansky-Custer-Hauser syndrome, Mullerian agenesis here. You have to understand that I have discussed Mullerian agenesis and androgen insensitivity syndrome in preceding part of my discussions here. So I will not go into the details of that. But I want to establish here how we have come to this how we have come to answer B here. We understand that we are talking about Mullerian agenesis, okay? We are talking about Mullerian agenesis. So structures which are derived from the Mullerian duct, that is uterus, that is the tubes and the vagina, they are absent. In the vagina, the part that is the upper part of the vagina is definitely absent. The endodermal part of the vagina might be present as a small blind vaginal opening. There can be a blind vaginal opening because of the endodermal part of the vagina, the part that is developing from the endoderm. Now this is just recapitulation of what we have studied earlier. Important aspect is, in Mullerian genesis, sometime the medial, I told you, the medial two-third of the tube is definitely absent. Sometimes the lateral one-third might be present as a remnant. Sometimes the lateral one-third might be present as a remnant, all right? We know this much. Secondly, we know that the ovaries, the gonads are ovaries, they are always present in Mullerian agenesis. So let us just in a nutshell summarize what we know. We know in Mullerian agenesis, the uterus is definitely absent. Blind vaginal opening from the endoderm can be present, more or less the vagina is absent. The tubes are absent, sometimes the medial two-third of the tube is definitely absent. Sometimes the lateral one-third might be present as a remnant. And we know that the ovaries are always present. So ovary, tubes, uterus, ovary, uterus, tubes absent. That is not a correct option because we know that the ovaries are always present. Uterus present, tubes and ovary absent. We know uterus is not present, it is never present. Ovary absent, no, ovaries should always be present. Uterus, tubes and ovary present. Now that is also a wrong statement, all right? So the corrected statement is that the uterus is absent, the tubes and ovaries are present. Okay, now the tubes are present. Again, this is answer we have come to by exclusion. Possible explanation is that sometimes the lateral 1/3 of the tube might be present as a remnant and the medial 2/3 of the tube is definitely absent. So by exclusion, the answer of this question number 151 is actually option number B. Now, moving on to the next question. Question number 152. Question number 152, the most favorable presentation for vaginal delivery is among here the most unfavorable position for unfavorable presentation for vaginal delivery is mento-posterior. In mento-posterior, there is no vaginal delivery possible. Mento-anterior, vaginal delivery possible. Occipito-posterior, vaginal delivery possible. Deep transverse, although in deep transverse, the treatment is cesarean section. The treatment is cesarean section in deep transverse arrest, but vaginal delivery can be possible with the manual rotation and forceps delivery or forceps delivery if the pelvis is deemed adequate. All right. So that is why among all these options, you should understand that in deep transverse arrest, the treatment we do is cesarean section. But even in deep transverse arrest, if the pelvis is deemed to be adequate, then a person can try. Books describe, and there have been times when manual rotation and forceps rotation can be achieved. However, in manto posterior, there is absolutely no chance of any vaginal delivery happening. So that is the most unfavorable presentation for vaginal delivery, all right?